This is Tarzan. Say hi, Tarzan.
Well, hi, everyone in Europe. God bless you out there. We love you.
Welcome to my home, our home, in North Hollywood, California, where we stay and retreat and just get away from the ministry and the madness. But at the time of my celebrity, I was living in Washington, D.C., and commuting out here just for the recording and for the Grammys and whatnot. But I moved out here almost 10 years ago.
A fool to ever leave your side. Me minus you is such a lonely ride. The breakup we had has made me lonesome and sad. I realize I love you 'cause I want you back.
Expected it to be as big and as popular as it was. I was just wanting to sing and wanting to have fun at that time in my life, and that's exactly what I did. When somebody first told me that we were nominated for a Grammy, I really didn't even know what that was, but I knew it must have been something. Now I watch them all the time. It's cool. But it was a busy time, and I thought it was going to launch me into a solo career at some point. I was with my partner only professionally. We got along like two sisters and a sister and brother. When I was 5 years old, I made an announcement that when I grow up, I'm going to be a star or a nurse. So, you know, I was determined somehow. I don't see how it really meant the same once something like that really actually happened to me. There's a lot of pressure on you when the public recognizes you. Success, anybody that sets a goal and is determined to make it, that can happen. But once you become famous or recognizable in the public, you hardly have any privacy. And that was very awkward for me. There'd be a lot of times when I'd be on a flight for 12 hours and get off the plane and people are flashing cameras away, you know. And I hadn't really learned how to control my temper. That's why I can really relate to a lot of celebrities that get very uncomfortable when people are just in their faces with cameras all the time. Because you're not really prepared, you're not really ready. And the public expects you to be. That was hard. But then again, you know, the limo rides and all the admiration and all that attention, that's great until you get that first bill. Coast, moved to Los Angeles, and looking for a producer, I was introduced to Steven. And when I met him, I thought, this will be a nice production. Yeah, and he even did something that I was not accustomed to. Even though my mom and dad raised us and we went to church, I didn't have a personal relationship with the Lord. But I thought, just because you go to church, you have one. Stephen explained it to me properly. Even though I had gone to some churches after I left Peaches and Herb, to just kind of get grounded again and see, well, I wonder, what should I do? And up until then, I was so success orientated that I think the Lord allowed those things to happen, but he wanted me to finally realize where my source had come from in the first place. And as I was seeking him and happened to ask him to bring about a husband in my life, a few weeks later I met Stephen.
I grew up 20 minutes from my wife, but we never met till we went to Los Angeles. In fact, I played football at her school, but she didn't go to any of the games, so she never saw me play. But I grew up outside Washington. The first 5 years of my life, though, I was in upstate New York, and I accepted Jesus when I was 5 years old. My father was president of a Bible school, and I walked in, told his secretary I wanted to see my dad, and it was great, even though my dad was president of the school, and he always had time for us kids. And I walked in, and he was sitting at his big desk, and he said, "What do you want, Stephen?" And I said, "Dad, I need to accept Jesus Christ as my Savior." He said, "You know what that means?" I said, "Yep," and I explained the whole thing. He said, "Great, kneel down." We knelt down, I prayed, accepted the Lord, and went outside and played. And that was when I accepted the Lord. Knew exactly what I was doing.
Upon me, upon me. Jesus Christ is standing up on me. Up on me. Up on me. Jesus Christ is standing up, up, up.
There's a rumor circulating that no matter how you're praying, God won't hear. Well, it comes from the accuser. He's nothing but a loser spreading fear. No matter how he lies,
no matter how he lies,
here's a fact.
Since I was 8, we would go down the inner city every Saturday, and we would work with an organization called Teen Challenge. And every Saturday night, we'd have a little choir, and we'd go witness in a place called DuPont Circle with all the drug addicts and the hippies. And I remember standing up as a little kid and singing and giving my little testimony. I remember guys come and pour beer over me and throw stuff at us, you know, but we would just, you know, keep on witnessing. And I just remember seeing, I remember people, you know, laughing and stuff. But I also remember people getting saved, kneeling down right in the middle of that place and accepting Jesus. And it always stuck with me. You know, that's why, I didn't know I was gonna do this. That's why I always have a love, you know, for the streets. And I saw the power of God. It was in a place where a little song or a little testimony, you wouldn't get a hallelujah or an amen. You got maybe mocked, you know, or. But I also saw people come to Jesus, and I remember sitting up with drug addicts and praying and seeing them throw up and going through cold turkey. And I saw the power of God. So that really always affected me.
If you're broken this afternoon, you're wondering, is this an accident? No, this isn't an accident. Some of you have to admit that you're feeling something in your heart, that you can't take that pain anymore, but you're afraid that God isn't pleased with you. He loves you. And Jesus loves you, and he wants to do something in your heart right now. And as we sing this song called Broken People, that's the very reason that Jesus came to this planet, for broken people. Not to build some great temple towards him, but he came for broken people. If Jesus was walking on the planet, he'd be down here, he'd be in the streets, he'd be with people that have been scorned by society. And you could live in the nicest home in Amsterdam or live in the street, but brokenness is brokenness. If you're honest with yourself right now, are you broken inside? Well, we're here to tell you that Jesus loves you, and he came for the broken people. Listen to the song. He did not come to start religion or be accepted by the crowd. He did not come to build a kingdom and fill it with the rich and proud. He did not come just for the righteous or for the strong and for the wise. He did not come to live in splendor and to ignore the wounded cry. If you're in one, you're why he came. Uh-huh. come for unknown reasons. That he keeps hid in mystery. He did not come cause it was pleasing.
No, 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 no.
He knew that place called Calvary. Pity was not his motivation. Why he reaches out to you. You are the crown of all creation. Yes, you are. Yes, you are. He has undying love for you. Don't you know? He came for all the broken people. Situation.
Hey, 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 yeah.
If you're in love, you're why he came. Are you in a hopeless situation? Is your life torn apart by pain? Does it seem like there's no way out? Don't you know that you're the very reason Jesus came to this planet? Don't you know he came for all the broken people? You're in one. You are Jesus.
Garage, and my wife, as you know, sold over 9 million records, and this is where we hang our gold records, out here in the garage. Not that they don't mean anything to Linda and all that stuff, but that's nice, but that's not what we shoot for now.
And I think it's healthier if you move on and move forward in your life and don't dwell on what you've done in the past. And when it's directed by God, you can do even greater things.
But this is important. I want you to see that this is my football helmet. The real football. See, this is what a real football looks like. Not that thing you kick around over there. This is football.
You know, if I had known you then, I would have been
your... I was a quarterback.
I would have been your greatest cheerleader.
You would have been?
Every 30 minutes in the United States, 29 kids will attempt suicide.
57 adolescents will run away.
14 teenagers will give birth out of wedlock.
22 teenage women will get abortions.
685 teenagers. 188 young people will abuse alcohol.
In LA, we have the largest prison system in the world for kids. There's over 15,000 children between the ages of 8 to 18 go to prison every year in LA County alone. And they're not in there for stealing hubcaps or just, you know, a lot of them in there for murder, triple murder. I've looked in the face of 9-year-old murderers. And you got 30 minutes with them. I mean, what can you do in 30 minutes? What can you tell them? What do you tell them to chant? You know, do you tell them to just get their life together? You tell them to go to school? That is what's so great about serving Jesus Christ. Because I know there's nothing that I can do really to change their life. But I know that Jesus can. And so that's why our responsibility is not even to go there so they'll like us, but to tell them the truth for the first time in their life. Because I know that Jesus, he doesn't even need 30 minutes, 30 seconds, he can change a life.
We all need forgiveness. And don't ever think that you've done too much that he can't forgive you. I wish I could bring just person after person in here that could tell you some horrendous things that went through in their life, but God forgave them and turned them around. Some of you have tried and tried and tried and tried to get your life together, but you just keep messing up. It's time you need help from somebody a lot bigger than you. I'm the same way. If we could do it on our own, God would have never come to this plan. He would have just said, fine, go ahead. Okay, we say if you have education and money and live in a nice house, then you'll be okay. There's just as many murders in those neighborhoods as any other place. There's much loneliness and unhappiness in those places. So what is the answer? The answer is finally getting in touch with somebody that's more strong, more powerful than anybody else. And that's Jesus. He loves you. Some of you don't even know who your parents are. Some of you think you're here by accident. You're not. You're not. You hear me? Society will tell you this. You're special if you wear the right suit, drive the right kind of car, and if your skin's the right color, then you're special. There's some people that hate you because of your color. There's some people that hate you because of your ethnic background. God says, I hate, that's a lie. I made you just the way you are. I love you the way you are. I love you the way you are. That's what God says. So don't you listen to what society says. I'm here to tell you, you're special, you're the best thing God ever made, and your life can change with his help. With his help. He cares about you.
There you go.
A lot of the kids here are gang-infested, drug-infested, and most of the role models are people who are dealing with these things. I hate to make excuses for a lot of these kids, but a lot of times that's all they know. So here in the probation department, we try to offer them and show them some other different ways to, when they leave here, to appreciate home. You'll see a lot of kids here who are kids that are here for murder, 187. And for the first time in their life, they'll be kneeling up, you know, kneeling down. They become humble, and they appreciate life a little more. And that's all we really can do. Other than that, they're going to move on to another step, to prison. And once they're there, it's a totally different world. And here, you know, hopefully they have a chance.
These are cross trainers. Reunited, and it feels so good. Reunited, 'cause we understood. There's one perfect fit, and sugar, this one is it. We both are so excited, 'cause we're reunited. Hey, hey. I said he's wearing the same old
wall. Oh.
Came back to life yesterday. I got your call.
what we do is not a career, it's a calling. So if we sell, I mean, our record did real good. It sold a whole lot, and a lot of people know us. A lot of people call us. A lot of people come to our concerts. Does that mean that we're being effective for the kingdom? Not necessarily so. You know some missionaries that go someplace and 40 years, maybe 8 people come to the Lord, but they're there because God said to be there. So our lives must be one of obedience. So I don't go on the results. If I see 100 people come to the altar after a concert and they're crying and screaming, I don't know. I mean, I believe, I'm hoping that that's real, but I don't know what's going to happen next week. How about I go to a place and they're real hard, nobody responds. Does that mean I was a failure? No, if we're there because God says, Steve and Linda, that's why I want you to go, then I'm going to obey him. Because if you manipulate the circumstance, you're responsible for the results. And I'm not going to manipulate any circumstance. So we try to, everywhere we go, we pray about it. Today, we're supposed to go where we're going. So I'm going to obey God. And whatever happens then, it's up to him and them. So I'm going to obey him.
These are our dogs, and this is the only trick they know. Okay? Here we go. Stay. 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 Okay. All right.